think it was a very, or it is a very appealing approach to look at the result of such negotiations, like the apparently very intransparent and shady ones that we observed 2 years ago, by trying to make some sense out of it, like what is the rationale behind it, because nothing in this sphere happens without that there is some rationale. So coming to the role of these intermediaries, it is true, of course, they do soften the transition period. They do offer a price which is below the previous agreement, the cost plus price, and the reference price, the netted back EU price, that is sort of the target. So in that sense, absolutely true, or I completely agree. There is a positive role that these intermediaries are playing in general. There is a big problem in the way this is set up, and this is that there is not only this function A, but there is also this function B, these limited exports. There were some speculation about how much gas these companies will be allowed to re-export. I think it was some 5 BCM or something, or 10 BCM, according to the contract documents that Yulia Tymoshenko released 2 years ago. If you re-export that to the EU, and the EU market can swallow that easily, as was said, then of course you make a lot of money. And so there is people for whom these intermediary companies, for whom this Rosuka Energo has created a lot of money. This is not only the Ukrainian side, Firtash and others. There's also this Gazprom share, and we do assume that people linked in the Kremlin are also associated with that. It's all speculation. We have no proof whatsoever, but there is a lot of money to be earned, and somebody must make this money. The problem is, if that situation is there, you create some sort of vested interest. People want to maintain this business because for them it's extremely profitable, and so we do see, or I do see, the danger that this good function that the intermediaries are supposed to play, the soft adjustment, is sort of misused by having it for a longer period than actually is necessary. So when will be the end of this transition period that the intermediaries provide? Probably the intermediary itself will have a very big incentive to have the scheme going on as long as possible. And that, I think, is the big problem here. The question is then, can we achieve something like this transition period without that there must be an intermediary company in the sense Rosuka Energo works, and can we achieve it in a way that not some private businessmen are making nice money by arbitrage deals? And I do think the principles, this is pretty much what was said yesterday by Mr. Sabrykin, the principles could be that policymakers, the Ukrainian president, the Russian president, and the heads of the gas companies, that they set up a frame contract. And this frame contract stipulates that within a defined period of time, say 5 years, Ukraine switches from current prices to world market price. And world market price is then the netted back EU price. To make sure that this net back EU price, what that will be, there should be an indication, an indexation of this price to some gas market price in the EU. You could take Zeebrugge, any other gas hub in the EU. It should be a price that is not directly under the impact of Gazprom, and it should be a price that is publicly available that you can just observe. So then it's clear that the net back price, the target price for Ukraine, is something that you can just calculate from available data. The next thing we need to know is the starting price. That could be 197.5 that we have right now, and say 5 years within which this transition has to be done. So in every year, you have a certain percentage that the price is going to increase. The last thing that we need to have is a certain quantity for how much gas is that valid, because it cannot be for whatever they consume. And with all these details, we have a pretty good package that would ensure Ukraine a soft adjustment. The only problem is, why should Russia agree to that? Why should Gazprom agree to that? Where's the benefit for Gazprom on that? And Ukraine does have a very significant asset in the gas sector that they could put on the table, and this is the GTS, the gas transit system. So what should be agreed is that there is going to be a concession with Gazprom and Naftogaz to operate the gas transit system, say a period of 20 years. The Ukrainian government receives a profit-based payment every year. So in that way, the intermediary would be replaced by this contract and by giving the GTS into concession, and there would be a regular payment to the Ukrainian government. So for the government, they would make sure that they get money out of this because they will receive the profits from the GTS. And at the same time, intermediaries are replaced, and there is no incentive anymore for anyone to block this transition period. And I think this would be a more practical and a less politically biased way to get this or to move towards competitive pricing than by using these intermediaries.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sabrykin, in the interest of time, because we had scheduled three commentators for this talk, waives his right and he will make comments during the open discussion at the end. So we will move directly to our second commentator, Martha Brill Olcott.
Thank you very much for a fascinating presentation that had so much detail in it and was so illuminating about the technical structures of the pricing system. I'd like to just make a couple comments about the sort of tension between what exists on paper and what exists in reality. And I have a real question about the last two sets of slides in that regard, the two that are added to the project. Yeah, if you could put up the last slide. Thank you.
This one or previous one?
Yeah, the purchase at the Kazakh border and the Uzbek border and stuff. Yeah, because I don't think that's accurate. And that's kind of what I mean by the difference, that there are multiple realities playing out in some of these transactions. And again, this isn't criticism, it's just the complexity of what's going on. I agree with you that it's a huge step forward in the movement now to understanding this as a kind of basket of gas with the prices. That's huge, and that's so in the end, I totally agree with, this is the solution.
That was my major aim, to show
that's right. This is the solution, and we're moving towards that place. And I'm totally agreeing with you that, like, I believe in 5 years' time or even 3 years' time, we're going to be in a totally more rational system, and these kinds of discussions that we're having are just not going to go on anymore. Where I disagree with you only is that there is still huge places of hidden profit in this system that are helping pay off valuable players. I know we agree on that. And that's kind of some of the two points I want to bring up about it. And I really want to know your answers on this. And, you know, this doesn't deal with the question of the use of the Central Asian gas en route. There's lots of money being, you know, there's transit that exists on paper, but in reality there's way less transit than actually exists because a lot of the gas is being used en route and you're not actually moving it all around. And there's greater efficiency on some of the Turkmen gas than on some of the Russian gas. So there's increased value. This use of gas in transit creates profit. Creates a different kind of rent that's not here. I mean, this exists everywhere in the world. I mentioned this yesterday, so no one's getting cheated on this. It's just a hidden profit point. And in your discussion, that's the first point. The second about the rents, I mean, we're using rent in two different ways. I mean, you're really using rent as sort of a discount value in pricing. And when we've been talking about it yesterday, we're using rent, I mean, you're using it the classic economic sense of it, and we're using it as a term of corruption.
But that is always the starting point.
I understand, but we have very different meanings.
Yes.
We have very.
That's why all these meetings are for, to define where we are.
I agree, and that's the second point that I think is really critical, because, you know, they didn't have to. You're 100% right to move from a political form of pricing to a non-political, to move from a political form of pricing to a non-political form of pricing, it was an enormous task, but it didn't have to be done through intermediaries. It could have been done through a semi-sovereign committee. What was there in the political price in the border were huge rents that were not discounts, right? That were corruption. People were able to make enormous amounts of money from the border trade themselves. I know it on the Central Asian side. I don't know who made the money on the Russian side. This is being recorded. I'm not going to speculate in public on who made it on the Central Asian side. But what the goods were priced at, they were priced high. I mean, but the people that actually the pricing was so complicated on the barter part that you and I would have delightful retirements if we had, exactly. We would have pleasurable retirements if we had even had 10% of the handling of that. You know, it's like it was huge sums of money. That's the second thing. This side, I'm concerned that this is not completely, having spent a lot of time tracking the sales agreements on each case, I think that this is a paper relationship in these transactions as it moves forward. But I don't, and that's why I'd like the slides from you, and we'll keep in touch on this question, because the actual purchaser varies from border to border. And in the Uzbek case, the Uzbek Gazprom controls the sale all the way through, and not Rasukra Energo, even if technically on paper they're listed as it. In the Kazakh case, the Kazakhs control the Turkmen gas all the way through, and then the question is, which is the gas that's being purchased, even if technically Rusukra Energo controls that gas? The Kazakh gas goes into the same pipeline, and a lot of it's bought differently. And you know, there's the Kazakh Russian gas company that controls the Orenburg refinery. So all this is sort of mixed in as well, and that's again like the transit issue. This maybe the structure on paper, but the actual structure in reality for handling the gas.
To say to everybody, that's of course contractual structure, because the physical flow
is totally different.
Because I'm quite convinced why I was putting this in dots, that of course Central Asian gas is not coming through all the pipeline. It's either the swap deal, either it's confused there, but it's in the system, it's the mixture of gases, of course,
but
and the quality differentials and other things, that are technical things, that none of the people in this audience do know how it's done, including me.
But this is one contractual structure, and there are other contractual structures for that same gas that totally contradict this. This is the contractual structure for the Turkmen gas that goes to Ukraine.
Yes.
But at the same time, the contractual structures for Turkmen gas that goes other places are totally different from this. So there's multiple contracts for the same gas flow.
Agree, because I was
arguing.
Ukraine, yes.
So that the actual role of the intermediary is much less real in reality. It's a contractual role and not a physical role. We can talk, but the point being that there's more rents.
I agree with you, that's correct, because the role of Rosukrenergo is to do this mixture of whatever else on paper, but to have an opportunity to show in the balance sheet that two different gases with two different marginal costs, different prices, different origin and everything, has an opportunity to mix together.
Right.
And to provide this lower price for Ukraine that will soften. Well, yeah. If I will be asked, I think that the people who were negotiating this, we can blame them with all the words.
It's not the negotiator.
But when they, in a very short time, have an opportunity to find this mechanism, I do understand that, of course, it will not ideal, but they were going, as you correctly saying, in the right direction.
But in reality, they're not the contractor for this gas. That's really my point. The contractor in each case is either Gazprom or the national company. And I'll stop.
And I think this is an issue we'll come back to, because this ties in with our last topic again of intermediaries. Thank you very much, Martha. Thank you, Ferdinand. And now we